Welcome to Sound Bites, hosted by registered dietitian nutritionist Melissa Joy Dobbins. Let's delve into the science, the psychology, and the strategies behind good food and nutrition.
Hello, and welcome back to the Sound Bites podcast. Today's episode is all about growing our awareness of Latino culture so we can be more effective as nutrition counselors and educators. My guest today is Krista Linares. She is a registered dietitian nutritionist who specializes in serving the nutrition needs of the Latino community, especially when it comes to education about type 2 diabetes management. Through her private practice, Nutrition Con Sabor, Krista strives to share culturally relevant and accessible nutrition advice for her clients, as well as encourage more Latino health professionals to enter the nutrition and wellness world. Krista's work focuses on dispelling myths and sharing information about Latin culture and cuisine, and most importantly, empowering Latinos to incorporate healthy, traditional foods and ingredients into a balanced meal plan for both emotional and physical nourishment. This episode is sponsored by Fresh Avocados Love One Today, and we thank them for their continued sponsorship and support of the podcast. Love One Today is a leading source of the healthiest reasons and tastiest ways to enjoy fresh avocados. As a science-based resource, Love One Today provides turnkey solutions that make it easy for health professionals to stay on top of the latest research and confidently recommend avocados. This podcast episode is also eligible for one free continuing education unit through the Commission on Dietetic Registration for registered dietitian nutritionists, dietetic technicians registered, and certified diabetes care and education specialists. You can visit the show notes for this episode or my CEU page at soundbitesrd.com for more information. Krista, welcome to the show.
Thank you. I'm excited to be here today.
I am really looking forward to learning more from you about Latino culture and getting a better understanding of the Latino community's values, traditional foods and meals, and your strategies in working in your community. I also want to talk to you about culturally driven ideologies about weight and hear your strategies and tips that you use in helping your clients successfully manage their blood sugar. We're also going to talk about building nourishing, satisfying meals using traditional Latin ingredients with a focus on overall wellness that is inclusive of a healthy weight while also supportive of a positive body image. So let's start with what inspired you to build a career in nutrition and work closely with the Latino community?
Well, I became interested in nutrition in my early 20s when I was diagnosed with both polycystic ovarian syndrome, or PCOS, and multiple food allergies. This brought up a lot of questions about what I could eat, how I could manage these conditions through nutrition. So I started exploring nutrition a lot that way. And healthy eating habits really do help manage PCOS. But all of the resources I was finding when I was looking into it had information on specific foods, or they had sample meal plans that did not include the traditional Latin foods that I had grown up with. So I felt very alone in that process. I even remember crying at family meals because I felt like I couldn't share in the same meal that my family was eating. So I felt very isolated. So this kind of led me to explore nutrition more. And I never wanted anyone else to have my experience that I had. And then as I began studying nutrition, I noticed that my community was really excited that they were going to have a Latina dietitian who understood our food culture. So I enjoy sharing nutrition facts and dispelling myths to help Latinos build healthy eating patterns while continuing to incorporate our traditional foods.
Very good. Thank you for sharing your story. Can you tell me a little bit more about the clients that you work with? Is it mostly adults, children, families? Are patients coming to you directly, or are they being referred by physicians?
Yeah, so I specialize in PCOS and type 2 diabetes. So because of that, most of my clients are mostly women in their mid-20s to mid-40s. And patients typically seek me out specifically because they want to work with someone who's familiar with their food culture. In the U.S., the rate of PCOS among Hispanic women is nearly two times the rate as in non-Hispanic white women. Furthermore, women with PCOS are often insulin resistant, increasing their risk for type 2 diabetes, with more than half of women with PCOS developing type 2 diabetes by age 40.
Yes, as a certified diabetes care and education specialist, I can relate to your interest in the insulin resistance, as PCOS and diabetes are closely tied with type 2 diabetes, I should say. So from a cultural awareness perspective, what would you say is the most inclusive way to describe this population? I want to get the terminology right. Should we say Hispanic, Latino? Is there another term that's better?
In my experience, the majority of people I work with use the term Latinos to describe themselves. Government data, like the CDC, uses the term Hispanic. So to quote statistics, I'll be using the word Hispanic because I want to accurately reflect what's in the data.
Okay, great. That makes sense. So I know that the Latino community includes many subcultures. Could you clarify for our listeners what ethnicities and regions the Latino community does include?
Yeah, great question. The Latino community includes a variety of cultures, and it's important to be aware of this as health practitioners, so we don't make assumptions. A very broad way to categorize the regions is Mexico, Central America, South America, and then Cuba, Puerto Rico, and the Dominican Republic. And even within these regions, there are a large variety of ethnicities. It's important to acknowledge that knowing someone is Latino is not enough to comprehensively understand their favorite ways to enjoy food. According to the census in 2019, Hispanics represent 18.54% of the U.S. total population and are the fastest growing population in America today. Among Hispanic subgroups, Mexicans rank as the largest subgroup at 61.4%. So keeping that in mind, I want to point out that my area of expertise is mostly Mexican cuisine and culture. So that's where I'll primarily focus our conversation for today.
Oh, okay. Great. Thank you. And as I mentioned in the intro, this podcast is sponsored by Fresh Avocados Love One Today. So as a spokesperson, do you encourage your clients to eat fresh avocados? And if so, why?
Yeah, avocados or aguacates are a great example of a heritage Latino food that provide a wide variety of health benefits. They contribute nearly 20 vitamins, minerals, and beneficial plant compounds that can enhance the nutrient quality of the diet. They provide naturally good fats and are a good source of fiber, both of which can help us feel more satisfied after meals. And from a culinary standpoint, avocados have this neutral flavor and creamy texture that goes well with many menus. I especially like to pair avocado with spicy ingredients in Mexican food.
Excellent. So some of my dietitian audience may counsel Latino clients. Are there any health statistics that our listeners should know, for example, like the prevalence of overweight and obesity or chronic diseases that Latinos might be at higher risk for?
So according to the CDC, Hispanics are traditionally more likely to be overweight or obese compared to non-Hispanic white adults. Data as recent as 2018 shows that in general, Hispanics are 1.2 times more likely to be obese compared to non-Hispanic white adults. And these statistics trend into children as well, with Hispanic children being 1.8 times more likely to be obese compared to non-Hispanic white children. Among Hispanic women, 78.8% are overweight or obese compared to 64% of non-Hispanic white women.
Okay, so let's talk more about that. Based on these numbers, is the Latino community at higher risk for heart disease and diabetes?
Well, in general, CDC data shows us that Hispanics are slightly less likely to have heart disease compared to non-Hispanic white adults. They also are less likely to die from heart disease than non-Hispanic white adults. But it changes when it comes to diabetes. If you're a Hispanic adult, the CDC is tracking that your chance of developing type 2 diabetes is more than 50%, and you're likely to develop it at a younger age compared to other U.S. adults.
Okay, so less likely to have heart disease and more likely to develop diabetes. Those are interesting statistics. Can you talk about some of the factors that might be driving this?
Yeah, there are a number of complex reasons that Latinos are at greater risk of type 2 diabetes. So according to the CDC, some of these reasons that are named are genetics, food culture, and lack of physical activity. And the evidence does show a strong genetic component to type 2 diabetes risk. But when it comes to food culture, it gets more complex when you think about the influence of acculturation. So for example, NHANES data shows that greater acculturation is associated with poorer diet quality in Mexican Americans, and that consuming a more traditional Mexican diet, which is strongly reliant on fresh foods, is associated with positive health outcomes, particularly in improving insulin sensitivity in women. Other factors to consider are the impact of income and education levels, which are both associated with health and type 2 diabetes risk. Looking at 2020 census data, we see Hispanics are more likely to have lower income levels and fall slightly behind on the percentage of high school graduates seeking higher education attainment. So when you look deeper into the data, you can see that the risk factors are really complex.
Mm-hmm.
And additionally, a recent Mintel report found that the pandemic triggered a dip in prioritizing eating healthy and exercise among Hispanics ages 18 to 44. So we may start to see this come up more often in our practice as dietitians as well.
Very interesting. Yeah, thank you for sharing these details. And I imagine dietitians are seeing various degrees of change because of the pandemic. It has impacted all of us and some of us in different ways.
Yes. So another thing to keep in mind is that Hispanics have the highest uninsured rates of any racial or ethnic group within the United States. And I see some of these challenges compounded by disparities in managed care for my clients. However, I find that by celebrating Latin food, it really helps my clients feel more comfortable and more empowered. A really important factor in the success of a health intervention is a client feeling like they are capable of making change. So when a client doesn't feel like they have to leave behind their food culture to make changes, it feels a lot more doable to them. A really common example is tortillas. We know how much carbs have been stigmatized. So many of my clients, especially those who come to me wanting to manage their diabetes, they come to their first appointment with me saying that this is going to be really hard for them because they love tortillas and a meal doesn't feel complete without them. So before we even start talking, I often see that they've already put up this wall and they're already thinking that they're not going to feel satisfied with their meals once they start this work. This is why nutrition education is so important. We need to help clients get the facts straight and focus on the fact that these favorite foods of theirs can fit.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more, especially with diabetes. The patients do come in totally expecting, not just sweet foods or sugary foods, but some of these staple foods in our diet, whether it's tortillas or orange juice or rice or whatever, that they're going to have those favorite foods taken away. And it's a huge barrier. So it makes sense that you would address that right off the bat. So thank you for reviewing some of these influences and the Latino community's higher risks for type 2 diabetes and giving us this cultural context. So many of my listeners have Latino clients facing these challenges, and we really value these insights. So let's continue talking about how we can take these insights and apply them so that we can maximize our success in giving nutrition counsel to Latino clients. Let's start with the foundation of the traditional Latino diet. Can you give us some specifics so we can get beyond those generic recommendations and potential assumptions and deliver a more customized approach when developing meal plans?
Yes. Yeah, so first, it's helpful to keep in mind that Latinos are not a homogeneous ethnic group. There's great genetic diversity and socioeconomic, educational, and demographic variations both between and within Latino ethnic groups. The contemporary diet of Latinos in the United States is influenced by traditional recipes and food preparation techniques, as well as what foods are native to their specific country of origin. Then you also need to layer in the influence of family traditions, personal preferences, and acculturation level, which means looking at and recognizing how their food culture has likely been impacted and changed as a result of incorporating habits and foods from American culture. So there are a lot of dynamics at play. But despite the expected variability, many Latinos in the United States still share some common core elements of a traditional diet, including a reliance on grains and beans, and the incorporation of fresh fruits and vegetables. My approach to nutrition counseling focuses on, first, celebrating healthy foods authentic to traditional Latino diets that deliver important nutrients and support healthy living goals. Families can more easily embrace and sustain new or modified eating patterns when they're based on ingredients that are already familiar and part of their culinary traditions. Second, I focus on debunking nutrition myths with science-based evidence. It's never too late to start eating healthy, but I often have found that we need to first clear up some common misunderstandings before someone can be confident about adjusting their food choices. And then third, sharing a lot of inspiration. Easy to prepare recipes based on authentic ingredients and visual guides are at the top of my list of resources to share. And I pay special attention to those that are available in Spanish and English to make it easier for my clients to enjoy and even share with their families.
Okay, great. So, Krista, you said you start by celebrating healthy foods authentic to a traditional Mexican diet. So, given our conversation is focused on helping clients reduce risk factors for type 2 diabetes, are there any specific nutrients or foods that you focus on?
I like to start by emphasizing dietary fiber because of its satiating effect and general health benefits. As you know, most Americans do not eat enough dietary fiber, yet diets rich in healthy foods containing fiber, such as some vegetables and fruits, may reduce the risk of heart disease, obesity, and type 2 diabetes. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, there are many heritage Latino foods like beans, corn tortillas, and fresh avocado that provide fiber. So, for example, in my practice, I elevate awareness that fresh avocado is a good source of fiber. In fact, 79% of an avocado's weight is fiber in water. And I explain how those 3 grams of fiber per serving, which is 1/3 of a medium avocado, help us feel more aware of our natural hunger and fullness cues. I explain the science that fiber actually slows the speed of digestion, which makes us feel full and may help us eat less and stay satisfied longer. I also flag how many fiber-containing foods are already in their kitchens, like avocados and beans, can help provide a feeling of fullness, but with fewer calories. That practical, straightforward education is well received and empowering, since most Latino households already favor these heritage foods and are thus open to building on them to increase their fiber intake.
I like how you talk to your patients about hunger, fullness, and satiety. And we know the dietary guidelines emphasize small changes. So clearly, the benefits of starting a discussion about healthy eating with foods they're already familiar with is wonderful. As the guilt-free RD, I think it's really important to help people become more aware of hunger and fullness. And that, I think, it takes some of the focus off of external or somewhat arbitrary cues, like trying to choose quote-unquote healthy foods or watching portion sizes. So let's dig into the science a little bit on this. What is the latest research about the role of fresh avocado and its influence on fullness and feelings of satiety?
Yeah, over on loveonetoday.com, there is a growing body of research investigating the relationship between whole foods like fresh avocado and the influence on appetite and gut hormone responses. One study in particular, funded by the Avocado Nutrition Center, investigated how the incorporation of fresh avocado in 3 different lunch meals impacted participants' post-meal gut hormone responses. The researchers took the study a step further and also explored whether there was an association between the gut hormone response and participants' subjective measure of appetite and satiety.
Very interesting. I'd love to hear more about the study.
So the study was a randomized 3x3 crossover trial with 26 healthy, overweight adults. All participants consumed a standardized breakfast meal and then consumed 1 of 3 test meals for lunch, an avocado-free control meal, an isocaloric meal with avocado, and an energy-increased meal where avocado was added to the meal. So this meal was higher in total calories than the other 2 meals.
Okay.
Researchers were specifically looking at 4 gut hormones, ghrelin, peptide YY336, gastric inhibitory peptide, GIP, and glucagon-like peptide 1, GLP-1, concentrations. These were measured at specific times before and after each meal.
Okay, let's pause for a bit and talk about these 4 gut hormones in this study. Can you tell our listeners about the role each of these hormones plays in appetite regulation?
Yeah, so ghrelin is known as the hunger hormone. It plays a crucial role in energy and glucose homeostasis. In addition to other things, peptide YY336, glucagon-like peptide 1, and gastric inhibitory peptide all slow gastric emptying and are known as satiety hormones.
Great, thank you. So to summarize, GLP-1, PYY, and GIP all decrease appetite and promote satiety, while ghrelin acts as the hunger hormone. Okay, so back to the study.
Yeah, in addition to getting blood drawn at a specific time point to measure the gut hormone levels, participants were asked a series of questions about their appetite and satiety sensations, and they rated their answers on a visual analog scale, so from 1 to 10, with 1 being the lowest rating and 10 being the highest. They were asked questions about their hunger, their fullness, satiety, their desire to eat, and how much they felt they could eat at matching time points when their gut hormone concentrations were measured.
And what did the results show?
When testing for possible associations between the visual analog scale measurements, so those subjective ratings of hunger, fullness, desire to eat, and gut hormone concentrations, researchers noted the appetite measurements were consistent with the expected changes in gut hormones. A sister publication to this study reported findings on glucose and meal satisfaction in the exact same set of study participants, noting that participants felt more satisfied and had less of a desire to eat following the meal when approximately 1/2 of a fresh avocado was part of the lunch meal. The subjects also had a lower immediate rise in insulin levels compared to the meal without avocado. Just like with all research studies, we must be thoughtful in how we contextualize these results. The conclusions from these studies cannot be generalized to larger, more diverse populations, but the results provide promising clues and a basis for future research to determine avocado's effects on satiety, glucose, and insulin response.
Ah, a very interesting research study. Thank you for sharing this, Krista. You also mentioned debunking myths as a second step in your process. And fad diets often cause confusion and certainly spread inaccuracies. So how do you tackle misinformation?
For example, we could talk about fats. One common misconception is that all fats are bad and should be avoided because they will make you gain weight. I find early on in a nutrition counseling session that I need to set the record straight, that the body needs some fat to help with nutrient absorption and that not all fats are created equal. There are good fats and bad fats. And as we know, managing the type of fat we eat is key to a healthy diet. So going back to using avocado as an example to help emphasize this message, avocados have this naturally creamy texture. Some clients get the misconception that they're high in these bad fats and that they have to limit consumption of avocado for fear of weight gain. I work with my clients to dispel this myth and help them understand that most of the fat in avocados is good fat. Delicious avocados provide 5 grams of monounsaturated fat and 1 gram of polyunsaturated fat per 50 gram serving in 1/3 of a medium avocado. I encourage other dietitians to leverage avocados' popularity in the Hispanic diet to start conversations about the different kinds of fat and why to focus on unsaturated fat for good health. I point out that avocados are essentially the only fruit that contains monounsaturated fat, which can help reduce LDL, bad cholesterol levels in your blood, which can also lower your risk of heart disease and stroke. And I teach clients that they can improve the quality of their diet by using foods with good fats, like fresh avocados, as a great substitute for foods higher in saturated fats, such as a full fat spread. Speaking of how avocados are a fruit with both fiber and fats, there's a great handout on loveonetoday.com for health professionals called The Dish on Avocados and Type 2 Diabetes that provides some guidance on meal planning, as well as updates on the science supporting how avocado may support type 2 diabetes management. For example, I was reading the summary about a clinical trial of 31 overweight or obese adults, which found when participants ate a half or whole avocado with breakfast that their blood glucose and insulin levels were lower. Of course, further research is needed, but it's these kinds of encouraging findings that inspire the Avocado Nutrition Center to continually explore the potential effects of avocado on satiety, glucose, and insulin response.
And what about carbs? Do you also find a need to address food myths about carbs? I mean, we touched on that, or we alluded to that a little bit earlier.
Yeah, in my practice, many clients believe that having type 2 diabetes means having to stop eating carbohydrates. So they are resistant and anxious about the thought of being denied their staples like corn, which is used to make tortillas or tamales, as well as favorite starchy vegetables like potato, yuca, or all types of squash. But as we know, carbohydrates, and especially complex carbohydrates like whole grains and fruits and vegetables, are necessary for energy, and it's more about managing them within a sensible meal plan. So for starters, I try starting a conversation acknowledging that foods like tortillas are delicious, important, and would be hard to limit. Establish that you understand their cultural preferences before jumping into diet modifications. Then move the discussion to smart ways to keep some carbohydrates on the menu, such as tortillas made from whole grain corn, and why knowing your carbs and counting them, not just the obvious ones, can be helpful in stabilizing blood sugar. After emphasizing more of the high fiber carb choices, I work with clients to determine their carbohydrate needs. Energy and carb needs are so individual, so I don't like to give the same portion recommendation to everyone. Often what I will do is start with a basic portion recommendation and then guide my clients through identifying the most common signs that they may need more or less carbs. So we'll talk about their energy level, hunger level, and even blood sugar if that's something they check regularly.
Okay, great. So tell me more about how you talk about incorporating fresh avocados with your clients. What kinds of resources are you finding that are most effective?
So clients are looking for simple, everyday recipes. My Latino clients love traditional dishes, but they're also open to incorporating kind of new fresh twists, especially when it means adding nutrition in without sacrificing flavor. Once my clients understand that fresh avocados are a heart-healthy fruit that contains satiating fiber and can help stabilize blood sugar, I help them identify new ways to add avocado to meals and snacks, including increasing the serving size.
Well, I love the idea about increasing their serving size. I understand that 1/3 of an avocado is quote unquote one serving, but this is something we see with diabetes, especially where, you know, a half a cup of pasta is a serving, but maybe it's not that person's individual portion. So I don't eat 1/3 of an avocado. I eat a half, sometimes a whole. So, you know, I think it's important that we address that with patients because it can get confusing. Do you have any tips that you can share with us that you use to inspire your Latino clients?
Yeah. So one really simple and delicious go-to is a basic avocado salad. This pairs really well with really common Latin meals and can be used as a quick meal or snack. It's easy and fast to prepare. I start with fresh diced or sliced avocado, some thinly sliced red onion, and then a light sprinkling of fresh cilantro, lime juice, olive oil, and salt and pepper. Additionally, there are resources like saboreaunohoy.com, which features delicious and nutritious recipes, helpful advice from Latino registered dietitians, and additional resources, all available in Spanish as well as English, and presented to be culturally relevant. For the recipes, I have confidence sharing them because they provide great step-by-step instructions in Spanish and English, quality photos, and informative nutrition labels. One of my favorite pages on saboreaunohoy.com right now is this compilation of avocado snack recipes that can help satisfy that midday hunger, which is especially tough to manage with so many of us still working from home. They have 5 spotlighted recipes, including a lime spice mini tostada with a guacamole topper, as well as a chocolate almond avocado oat bite recipe. And all this content is available in English and Spanish to make it easy for clients to use and enjoy.
Excellent. I will be sure to add all of those links in the show notes. What are some of your most effective strategies when you're talking with patients or clients about ways to incorporate the dietary guidelines recommendations into the traditional Latino meal plan?
So in my practice, I like to emphasize meal timing and consistency first, as well as getting enough protein, fiber, fruits, and vegetables. By focusing on these areas, my clients see reduction in cravings throughout the day. I found this allows my clients to naturally moderate their portions in a way that's in tune with their own cues. Then, if my clients need more structure, I help them visually map out their plate using guides that help with portions, for example, My Plate. The Love One Today and Saboreo Uno Oi websites have a great My Place resource for type 2 diabetes management. The resource visually helps clients organize their plates to keep blood sugar levels in check using the My Plate method. This downloadable visual aid is available in English and in Spanish.
Okay, I'll be sure to link to that in my show notes as well. It's really great to have a visual tool in Spanish and English. Now, weight management and reducing risk factors for diabetes are very closely linked. So how do you approach that topic with your clients?
Yeah, this can be a difficult topic, but it's important. Latino culture traditionally sees being curvy as a sign of health and not necessarily a health problem. And as Latina women acculturate, they may feel conflicted on what to value, as American beauty standards value thinness. Also, I don't know if you have encountered this, but it's not uncommon for Hispanic people to use nicknames based on physical descriptors. This can include hair color, skin color, body size, and family using nicknames, like a common one, for example, is gorda, which is referring to someone being bigger. They may say these nicknames as a term of affection, especially toward children. However, as people age, and especially as Latino individuals acculturate, these nicknames that seem harmless can feel like a label and make people feel really self-conscious about their appearance. So all of this is to say that you need to approach talking about weight with a lot of sensitivity and openness to hearing how culture influences personal and familial expectations.
Absolutely. Weight can be a very sensitive topic. I mean, diabetes is sensitive enough, and they each have their own set of concerns or stigma. They're different yet related. So that makes a lot of sense. And I appreciate you sharing more of the cultural background there with the nicknames. I was not aware of that. So as we continue to talk about fullness and satiety, let's talk about snacking. Do you have any of your favorite recommendations or tips for clients about smart snacking?
Yeah, I encourage my clients to think of snacks as basically a nutrient-dense mini meal. I especially like to emphasize nutrients that provide satiety, like fat and fiber. So, for example, I encourage my clients to make guacamole from scratch so that they can control what goes in there. Guacamole made from fresh avocado is a classic snack that provides both fat and fiber. The Haas Avocado Board has their classic guacamole recipe that goes really great with veggie sticks like jicama or carrots. Another important component of snacking is satisfaction, and not just in terms of physical fullness, but also in terms of how enjoyable the snack was and asking, did it hit the spot? In Mexican culture, a really big part of satisfaction is having a bold flavor, like spicy or tangy or both. So I definitely encourage clients to use big flavors like lime juice or chile to make their snacks as satisfying as possible. With guacamole, this could mean adding this big squeeze of lime juice on top.
I love this idea. I love lime juice. So this classic guacamole recipe, it's a bit different than what I typically make. And I agree 100%. Homemade guacamole is so much better than the store-bought. to me, it's a completely different thing altogether. So I have my famous guacamole recipe that I make. I use a lot of lime juice and a lot of cilantro. So it's delicious. So let's wrap up with some actionable insights for health professionals counseling Latino clients. What are some strategies you'd like to see health professionals incorporate into their nutrition counseling practices?
The most important thing you can do is familiarize yourself with common Latino foods. The goal is to close the gap and help clients feel that you're with them every step of the way. So when their dietitian can speak to cultural foods and traditions, it really helps clients feel like they can be successful in taking steps to improve their health. But I want to add the caveat that this doesn't mean we're making assumptions about people based on their ethnicity. I like to frame it as knowing what questions to ask to help clients fully open up to you about their experiences and their culture.
Yes, that's one thing that I have really learned is asking questions is really key. And the more we learn about different cultures, we can ask better questions. So can you share some examples of some open-ended questions that you ask your clients?
Yeah, so some questions that can help dietitians get a sense of a client's cultural food patterns includes asking questions about what they typically eat, and especially asking how weekends are different from weekdays. We see a lot of people have family events on weekends, so those might be the times when they're eating more cultural foods than, say, during the work week. I also ask a lot of questions about how they decide what to eat, who's making the meals, and I might even ask questions about how the meal is served. Is it served family style, or are they given a plate of food already dished out? This can help illuminate some cultural food patterns, but also some family dynamics that may be less likely to come up in non-Hispanic groups.
Yeah, I mean, all dietitians know that we want to get an idea of what somebody's eating during the week versus the weekend, but to your point, with the cultural foods in the family events, I hadn't thought of it in that way. So that's really helpful. So what are some resources for dietitians to help continue building their understanding of Latino cuisine and these culturally inclusive counseling strategies? Is there anything that you can share with us?
Well, first, I would suggest for dietitians to think long-term about the diversity within our field and how having a more representative body of nutrition professionals can help serve our clients. This means setting up systems or encouraging Latinos to enter the field. Mm-hmm. In terms of resources, there are some great resources specifically around communication with Latino clients. The CDC has a good resource about communicating with Latino patients, and the LAHIDAN, MIG, also has great resources on cultural competency. And of course, the Aguacates Frescos Saboreo No Oe website is full of culturally relevant resources that you can share with your clients.
Very good. And you mentioned the LAHIDAN, MIG, or MIG, and that's through the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics. So I'll put a link in my show notes to that as well. I'm curious, what is your favorite way to eat fresh avocados?
Yeah, my favorite way to eat fresh avocado is by mixing it into a salsa verde. And this adds into the salsa some key nutrients, color, flavor, and this creamy element to some of my favorite staples like tostadas or even scrambled eggs.
Mm, excellent. And I also like adding diced avocado into salsa for added texture and nutrition. I put diced avocado on soup, sandwiches, salads, everything. Okay, so I'm going to summarize some of our key takeaways today. You can correct me if I say anything wrong, but I've got Latinos in the U.S. are comprised of many ethnicities coming from diverse parts of the world, including Mexico, Central America, South America, Puerto Rico, and Cuba. But despite this expected variability, many Latinos in the U.S. still share some common core elements of a traditional diet, including a reliance on grains and beans and the incorporation of fresh fruits and vegetables. Also, Latinos are at higher risk for diabetes. In fact, there is more than a 50% chance that all U.S. Hispanics will develop type 2 diabetes over their lifetime. While genetics play a role, the impact of acculturation on diet quality, along with the influence of economics and education, should also be considered. This also includes difficulties some Latinos may face finding bilingual nutrition resources that resonate. So in order to be effective, health professionals should strive to better understand that influence and integrate insights and bilingual tools into their counseling practice. Krista, your tips, including celebrating healthy foods authentic to the traditional Hispanic diet, like fresh avocados, using this popular staple to illustrate the importance of fiber and debunk myths about fats and carbohydrates. In addition, Krista, you recommend sharing easy recipes, visual guides, And you can start building up your library of bilingual resources by visiting, I will try to say this right, sabariaunohoy.com. How did I do?
Great.
I have always wanted to learn Spanish. Right when I got out of graduate school and worked in clinical in South Chicago Hospital, I said, I want to learn Spanish. And by gosh, I never have done it. I need to do it. So as a reminder, all the links to research, recipes, and resources will be available in my show notes. And everybody can find those by going to soundbitesrd.com. And it's also through any podcast app or platform you listen to your podcasts on. I do also want to mention that I have a related episode. It's episode 181, Cultural Humility and Health Literacy. My guest was Lorena Drago, and she is a well-known and respected health professional in the multicultural space. So I really encourage people to check that episode out as well. And this podcast, again, is eligible for one free continuing education unit through the Commission on Dietetic Registration. And you can visit the show notes or my CEU page for more information. And of course, don't forget to check out the Health Professional tab at loveonetoday.com, where you can find more about nutrition research, free educational materials, and tasty, satisfying, and easy-to-make recipes. LoveOneToday.com also has a quarterly newsletter exclusively for health professionals to flag new research as it comes in, as well as updates on exciting CEU opportunities like this podcast. Thank you all for tuning in, and special thank you to Krista for sharing all of this valuable information. Thank you to Fresh Avocados Love One Today for supporting this podcast episode. If you are loving these avocado-centric episodes and want more, please be sure to scroll back to episodes 150, 158, and 175 with Marissa Moore, episode 163 and 191 with Patricia Bannon, and episodes 164 and 179 with Aaron Polinsky-Wade. Each of these accredited episodes dives into a unique study and, of course, includes a wealth of additional tasty avocado tips and tricks. Plus, stay tuned for the final episode of this year's series with LoveOneToday.com, where I sit down with Dr. Nikki Ford, the Senior Director of Research at the Avocado Nutrition Center, and learn about her role guiding research strategy to grow the body of credible nutrition health research to inform public health about the benefits of fresh avocados. So Krista, thank you again so much for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me.
And for everybody listening, as always, enjoy your food with health in mind and some nutrient-dense avocados. Till next time.
For more information, visit soundbitesrd.com. Music by Dave Burke, produced by JAG and Detroit Podcasts.